You must understand that a secular, who is a secular? A secular is one who never says anything against a Muslim, however wrong thing a Muslim has done. A secular is one who never says anything. On the other hand, anybody who has said anything in favor of Hindus can never be secular. He is communal. This value system was grafted on this nation by Jawaharlal Nehru, earlier than that by Mohandas Karamchand Gandhi, and this has been sanctified by the leftists. This has been sanctified by a whole lot of pet and paid intellectuals, so-called intellectuals, so that this had got into the Bengali psyche. You ask me about West Bengal. I would not like to elaborate on this thing, but I would only say that BJP has committed political suicide in West Bengal. It could have come to power in 2021. They simply let it slip through their fingers. Thank the audience for giving me this opportunity to speak on something that I have seen in practice with my own eyes over the last how many years? Since 1967, I would say. Since 1967, that was a time when I had just left college and joined work. And at that time, I was away from Kolkata, so I did not know what was happening in Kolkata, but I came back the same year. And then since then, I have been observing the antics of the leftists in the party, in the state. The first thing that we noticed is that everybody has starts talking politics. I have mentioned in the introduction of my subject that one of the characteristics of left politics is to over-politicize the polity. Everything is politics. Today, the situation in West Bengal is that anything, say from purely political matters, down to, say for instance, what I have seen with my own eyes, appointment of a professor in an engineering college or in an university, then down to admitting a patient in a hospital, then down to even poultry farming. Everything in West Bengal is political. The police are completely politicized. The administration is politicized. There is nothing outside politics. In fact, one of the left leaders, Anil Biswas, who was the Supremo of West Bengal, he died a early death. He had said these very words, Rajnitir baire kichu hoy na, which in Bengali means there is nothing outside politics, everything is. So you must understand that according to the standards prevailing in West Bengal now, there is no good and bad. There is no right or wrong. There is no good and evil. There is no moral and immoral. There is only politics, whether you belong to this party or you belong to that party. This has completely corrupted the value system of the people, and the result is what you see today. But I've sort of jumped the gun, so let me go back to 1967. And explain or describe to you the gradual deterioration of the state over all these years. It has been how many years? So the point is, the gradual deterioration that I have been talking about, it started in 1967 when the Congress government was voted out of power and the government called the United Front, consisting of mostly left parties, but also a Congress offshoot called Bangla Congress came to power. the entire period between 1967 and 1972 was a period of anarchy in West Bengal. During this period, there had been two elections and period and intervening periods of president's rule and a lot of agitations. And eventually in 1972, the Congress came to power. But by that time, the Congress had also changed into a quasi-left party. And they lasted for 5 years, in the middle of which there was emergency. And then after that, from 1977 to 2011, we have had uninterrupted left front ruling the state. And thereafter, another party, that is Mamata Banerjee's Trinamool Congress, which says that they are against the CPM, but they copy the CPM absolutely line for line. So what did the leftists do? How did they begin their rule? How did they begin their nefarious activities back in 1967? Between 1967 and 1972, I'll give you just one or two examples. See, there is a town called Bardhaman near Kolkata, which many of you know. In this Bardhaman town, there was a family abode called the Sai Bari. It was the abode, it was the home of the Sai family. This Sai family, they were Congress supporters. There were two brothers, Molay and Pranab Sai. These two were one day just eating, sitting on the floor. Their mother was serving them. A CPM procession was passing by somewhere else. They suddenly changed route and stormed into the Sai house, that is Sai Bari, and entered the place where the two brothers were eating and their mother was serving them, and just slit their throats. The brothers sat there just writhing in pain and bleeding to death. These people, they picked up the blood and made little balls of rice and fed it forcibly to the mother. The two brothers, her own two sons' blood, made into balls with rice and fed it to the brothers. Then a CPIM leader called Hare Krishna Konar justified it. He justified it saying that this kind of thing is bound to happen for those who oppose the CPM. Whoever opposed the CPM will come to this end. So this is how it started. Then during this, in the meantime, another process had started, which was the Naxalite or the Maoist thing. That also started in the year 1967 with some kind of agrarian revolt. These people were a breakaway group from the CPIM. You know, originally there was one Communist Party of India which broke into the CPI and the CPIM in 1964. Then in 1967, the CPIM came to power. The CPI remained out of it. But an ultra-left faction, which called itself the CPI-ML, Communist Party of India, Marxist-Leninist, they broke away and they formed the main Naxalite party. And they were called Naxalites because the first revolt took place in Naxalbari. Then there was a very murky story followed, and the period between 1967 and say 1973 or 74 into the Congress regime, there was rampant destruction of property and killing of people right and left, all based on actual or assumed political affiliations. A person was said to be a CPIM supporter, so the Naxalites came and killed him. He was perhaps not a CPIM supporter. Somebody just took a revenge on him because he had a personal grudge against him. The opposite thing also happened. Congress also, to an extent, joined in this fray, and they also did it. This process went on, but in 1972, the Chief Minister, Congress Chief Minister Sh.Tathagata Roy, after coming to power, he started right and left killing of the Naxalites. It's a very unfair thing to do, but it put a stop to the Naxalite thing. Naxalite problem has, as far as I understand, now broken into 27 parties, 27 Naxalite parties, and each one of them claim that we are the true Naxalites, we are the true Maoists. Some of them are more powerful, like the MCC, the Maoist Coordination Center, and Maoist Communist Center, and a few others. Well, there's one called Liberation, there's one called Second Central Committee. We need not go into any of that. The point was, there were rampant political killings right through this period, which stopped around 1973 or 74. But from 1967 onwards, the industrial degeneration in the state also started. You would remember, those of you who have studied the history of this period would remember that West Bengal was sort of the industrial hub of India at that time. The deposits of coal and a lot of iron ore were largely in West Bengal. And because the British had started their rule of India from Kolkata, at that time it was Calcutta, and they had the advantage of a riverine port at Calcutta. And because of a large number of advantages, infrastructural advantages, the whole of this belt from Calcutta right up to the border of West Bengal and Bihar in a place called Baraka, it was dotted with industries. Only yesterday or day before yesterday, I got a message over WhatsApp from a gentleman called Adit Jain. He heads an outfit called IMA India. He had grown up in a place called Kumardhubi, which is in Bihar, just outside the West Bengal border. And he said that at that time, if one drove along the Grand Trunk Road, which is now the National Highway number 2, from Kumardhubi to Calcutta, one would see hundreds of factories, literally hundreds of factories. There were this Indian Iron and Steel Companies, cast iron works in Kulti. There was a Kerouz distillery. Then there were these collieries in the entire Asansol belt, Asansol Raniganj belt. There was Hindustan Pilkington, there was Sendrale, there were so many things. Then into Durgapur, there was mining and allied machinery, there was the steel plant, all these factories were there. Now, what happened is that in 1967, in that United Front Ministry, there was a small constituent called the Socialist Unity Center of India. This party is practically not known outside West Bengal. In fact, in West Bengal also, they have dwindled to a very small number. But this party had a representative in the cabinet whose name was Subodh Banerjee. Subodh Banerjee was the labor minister. And he gave a dictum that Gherao, which literally means surrounding people, surrounding or besieging. Gherao is perfectly legal. If somebody is gheraoing some industrialist, then the police will not go and interfere. Now, this thing was lapped up by all the union leaders at that time. The union leaders were largely left-oriented. There were some Congress leaders also, INTUC, but they also gravitated to the left. And it was, this thing was lapped up, and then this Gherao started. Gherao's, I have myself experienced a Gherao, because at that time I was a very young engineer officer in the Indian Railways, and I had myself faced Gherao, and I know what a tormenting experience it was. You would be surrounded by about, say, 50 to 100 people inside your office or outside in the hot sun or in pouring rain, who would be shouting slogans and yelling obscenities at you. And you had to keep your head, because if you didn't, then you would be manhandled, you could be killed also. This message that I got from this Aditya in a few days back, it said that when he was working in Durgapur steel plant, not as a employee of the steel plant, but as a employee of his father's company, which had been entrusted with some construction work in the steel plant, he was made to stand on a barrel in the hot sun of Durgapur, sometime in the height of summer, while some 100 people surrounded him and kept on shouting slogans and yelling horrible things about him. The person has said that I had no idea what my fault was, why these people are shouting at me. But that didn't matter. The point was that the labor minister had declared that Gherao was legal, and therefore Gherao was going on. This started the flight of capital from West Bengal. This flight of capital, you must understand, was not something that was not desired by the leftists. They wanted people to, wanted capital to fly. Why? Because if people are employed, people are happy with their jobs. People go to office or go to work or go to factories, come back, and then they spend time with their family, teaching something to their children and spending time with their wives, then who would go out and do processions and shout Lal Jhande Ki Jai with the communists? So they wanted people to be unhappy. They wanted people to be unemployed. And this is what happened right through this period. I wouldn't bore you with the details of all the factories that were closed, and all the head offices of the premier private sector companies that had moved away from Kolkata. Just to give you a few examples, Philips India ran away, Reckitt Coleman Benckiser ran away, Gestkin Williams later on closed, Jessup and Company closed, Burn and Company closed, so many. The entire point was to make people unemployed so that they could swell the ranks of the processionists. Because people, as I said, if people were employed, then they wouldn't come to the processions. Why should they come? So that was their pattern. Not only that, even for people who were not working in factories, say agricultural laborers or otherwise daily laborers in cities, teachers, the design of the leftists was to make them, was to keep them in discomfort, some kind of discomfort. Something, say for instance, at that time, milk was sometimes difficult to get. So just to get a card of milk, government milk supply was difficult. Similarly, getting a telephone was almost impossible. So for all these things, they were forced to come to the party office, not to the relevant government office, but the party office, because the party office, the government office, relevant government office would not entertain anything without the say-so of the party. I'll give you one example. Say, for instance, this was a very common experience in villages or smaller towns, not so much in Calcutta. Say, for instance, in a hospital, all hospitals were overcrowded. So in a hospital, you had two intending patients who wanted admission. Say one was suffering from cancer and the other one was suffering from some trifling ailment, say common cold or some bronchitis or something like that. Who would be admitted would not depend on how bad his need was. Who would be admitted would depend on who he has been recommended by. I have seen things in my own university. You know, I taught in Jadavpur University, which is one of the premier universities in the eastern part of India. Supposing this is an hypothetical example, but I have seen similar examples. Supposing a professor is to be appointed in a department. Now, the essential qualifications of a professor are laid down by the University Grants Commission, UGC. But two things the university can dictate. That is, one is the desirable qualification and the second is the specialization. So supposing in the physics department, their possible specializations are quantum mechanics and solid state physics. Now, who would be, which specialization would be mentioned in the advertisement? It would depend on if you stipulate solid state physics, then who would be applying and who have they been recommended by? On the other hand, if you stipulate quantum mechanics, then who would be coming? Depending on this, the entire advertisement would be manipulated. And this is how the entire system functioned. This is what was encapsulated in one word that this man said, Anil Biswas, that there is nothing outside politics. Rajnitir baire kichu hoy na. This was the extent to which this thing has been corrupted. Industries just went on vanishing from the state, one after another, one after another. We went to, at that time I was a very young man. I wasn't in politics. I was a simple engineer. Everything seemed very odd to me. So I asked some people who had leftist tendencies. So I said, I asked them that all these industries are running away. What will our people do? Where will they get employment? He said, "Arey, bhag ke jayega kahan? Sab lal ho jayega. Every place will go communist." Then I thought that there is something wrong in it. And then I started. That is one of the things that got me interested in politics, because I thought that something ought to be done about it. Otherwise, this vacuum in politics being left to the dregs of society is what has put us in this terrible jam. But anyway, so the industries were running away. The educational institutions were being corrupted. The government services, the administration, the police, they were all being politicized. I'll give you one or two more examples. Say, for instance, in 1978 or 79, there was a genocide, a mass killing, I would say, not to the extent of genocide. Say, some 5,000 people were killed in a place called Marichhapi, in the Sundarbans Delta of the Hooghly River. What had happened in Marichhapi is very interesting. It had a long history. The refugees from East Pakistan who had been driven out by Islamic persecution and who had no employable skills in India. A lot of people who had employable skills in India, employable skills, they came and they found employment. Say, for instance, schoolmasters, or shopkeepers, or doctors, or lawyers, they found employment. But people who were into, say, fishing or into agriculture, they found no employment because West Bengal was deficit in land and water. So they became the charge of the government, and the government neglected this thing very badly. In fact, Nehru, that's a different story. I'm not going into that. But these people became destitute and they were not given the sort of rehabilitation that Punjabi refugees were given. A lot of people are under the impression that the Punjabi refugees are very hardworking and the Bengali refugees are feckless. This is not at all correct. Punjabi refugees are definitely hardworking, but they had been given rehabilitation in colonies like, for instance, Kalkaji or Lajpat Nagar or Rajendran Nagar, these places. They had been accommodated in even agricultural land in places like Pilibhit. And more than anything else, in Punjab, the exodus was both ways, you know. Muslims left Indian Punjab and went to Pakistani Punjab. On the other hand, the Sikhs and Hindus, they came from Pakistani Punjab and came to Indian Punjab. As a result, there was complete exchange of population, and the India, the Sikhs and Hindus who came to India, they found they could use the properties that had been left by the Muslims of East Punjab, that is Indian Punjab. But in West Bengal, there was no such thing. It was a one-way exodus. Only the Hindus came from East Bengal. The West Bengali Muslims did not go to East Bengal except for a very small number, middle-class people who wanted, and they also kept their property over here. They wanted good job opportunities, so they went. So this kind of thing happened, and there was no rehabilitation arranged by the Nehru government. So as a result, these people lived in under horrible conditions. And at the time, there was one scheme launched that which said that these people were going to be rehabilitated in the Andaman Islands. Then the CPIM, these leftists, they had agitated. Now I'm talking about an earlier period, that is early 1950s. And 1950s generally, these people had were to be rehabilitated in Andaman Islands, and therefore they were told to go to Andaman Islands, which has a climate like East Bengal. But the leftists told them that you mustn't go. We will provide you rehabilitation in West Bengal. So some of them went, some of them did not go, and the ones who did not go, ones who fell prey to these provocations of the left leaders, they were in a horrible soup. Eventually, they were sent to a place called Dandakaran, what is now Chhattisgarh, Odisha, and Andhra. There, they suffered very badly because Dandakaran is a very dry and arid place. But anyway, when the leftists came to power in 1977, and mind you, these refugees were all people into kind of basic professions like agriculture and farming. So when the leftists came to power in 1977, and incidentally, they were also almost all scheduled caste. So when the leftists came to power in 1977, these people thought that these leftists had been telling us earlier that they will give us rehabilitation in West Bengal. So we must demand rehabilitation in West Bengal. They will suddenly give it to us. Then they sold everything that they had in Dandakaranya, and they traveled in trains to Kolkata. Jyoti Basu, the chief minister, he said, nothing doing, you go back. Complete volte-face. And these people are not prepared to go back. They had burnt their boats. So they decided that they will do something for themselves, and they sailed in boats to a riverine island called Marichapi in the Sundarban Delta, and there they tried to set up agriculture. Then the Jyoti Basu's government, they sent both the police and CPM gundas to beat them out of that place. They besieged the place with the result that that water is brackish, you know. You don't have drinking water over there. Drinking water has to be brought in boats from the mainland. They stopped the supply of drinking water. Little children had died in front of their parents' eyes. And the parents also, when they tried to swim across, then they were eaten up by crocodiles or estuarine sharks. And they were all driven out of that place. The press was completely shut out of this process. This tragedy of Marichapi, almost a genocide, it is now coming to the fore only now. But because the media are media and the certain class of media professionals are dominated by the leftists, this is not coming out as well as it should. So this is one of the things that they did. Another thing that the leftists did was to stop the teaching of English, because the idea was that if the students learnt English, then they would be able to know about what is happening in the other parts of India. They would be able to know about what's happening elsewhere in the world. So they found some obscure quotation from Rabindranath Tagore that the mother tongue is a mother's milk in education. And they forced the schools, particularly government and government-aided schools, they forced all of them to give up teaching of English. But the private schools kept on teaching English from class one or even from kindergarten. And all these communists, grandsons, grandchildren, children, they all went to this private school. They didn't go to the government school. It is only the people who had no money to go to private schools, who were forced to government and government-aided schools, they had to go there and be subjected to this defective system of education. When I was teaching in Jadavpur University, I saw that my students who had come from these rural areas, who were of, very good merit, but not enough money. Their parents did not have enough money. When I found these people, they had all the material, I mean, whatever was needed to be known by way of engineering, they had it all in their brains, but they couldn't express it because they did not know any English. Bengali was the only language they knew, and Bengali was no good because there were no jobs to be got in Bengal. So this is the kind of thing they did. Plus, they did murders. Murders galore. Just to give you one example, right in the middle of Kolkata on the 30th of April 1982, absolutely, as they say in Hindi, Din Dahari, 17 Anandamargi monks were doused in kerosene and set on fire. Unbelievable. Right in the middle of Kolkata, in a place called Bijan Setu, right next to Baliganj railway station, 17 Anandamargi monks were set on fire, were doused in kerosene and set on fire. Then OC of Tiljala Thana. Tiljala is a police station. OC means what you call an SHO in Delhi. This OC, he was shot at point blank range by a CPM goon. Couple of CPM goons came there, just shot him and went away. And nobody had so far been convicted. Then in 1990, one of the most horrible things to happen, two women officers of the West Bengal government, and one of them belonged to UNICEF, I think, some international agency. They had gone on some family planning mission to some remote area. And when they were returning, they were accosted by a crowd. And this crowd started threatening them. Then the driver started, it was a Maruti van, you know, very unstable thing. So when the driver started trying to escape, but the van overturned. Then these people came and caught these two ladies, they raped them, they gang raped them, and they killed the driver mercilessly, horribly. And they not only gang raped the women, they did such things that defy description. I can't say it. But I just tell you how horrible it was that when these ladies, their bodies went for postmortem, the postmortem surgeon, who are normally very hardened people, postmortem surgeon fainted at the sight of what had been done to one of these women. They were government officers. No conviction. No one has been convicted because the government, the machinery, the administration, the police, they were all absolutely in cahoots with the political party. They were all politicized. This thing kept on going one after another. This incident that I have referred to you is called Bantala incident. before Bantala, there was this Anandamargi incident, then Bantala, then Chota Angariya, then Netai, all these things, they happened. And finally, of course, in 2011, they were ousted from power. Meanwhile, after Jyoti Basu was deposed, Buddhadev Bhattacharya became the chief minister, and he had some kind of conscience. In spite of being a doctrinaire communist, he had some kind of conscience, and he thought that this can't go on. We must try to industrialize the state. So he managed to get Tata Motors to invest in the state, and he earmarked some area for Tata Motors factory. And Tata Motors had started building that factory, and they had invested some 1,500 crores in constructing that factory in a place called Singur. Now, there was some agitation against this factory because the people who were losing the land for the factory, they had it's a very rich agricultural land. They said that there was land available elsewhere, etc. Trinamool Congress, meanwhile, under the leadership of Mamata Banerjee, had risen up as the principal opposition against the CPIM, and Trinamool Congress started opposing this construction of this thing. It went on to such an extent that Tatas got exasperated, and they said that we have invested 1,500 crores over here. All right, we are giving it up. We don't want to do anything here. We don't want to have to do anything with West Bengal. And the Tatas went away. They founded their factory in Sanand in Gujarat. So the communists were ousted from power in 2011, and Mamata Banerjee came to power. Then what we saw was that Mamata Banerjee was following exactly in their footsteps, line by line she was following, line by line, with only one difference. The difference was that in the Communist Party, there was a very rigid structure. You know, at the top of the thing, there was the state secretary, below the state secretary, there was the state committee, then there was a zonal, there were zonal committees, then below zonal committees, district committees, then local committees, branch committees, and all that. With the result that some order given at the very top, it filtered down the structure and went down to ground level, and there it would be obeyed. And then a feedback would go on all the way up to the top. Now, Mamata Banerjee's party had no structure. Mamata Banerjee had made sure that in her party, there would be only one leader, and that is herself. In fact, the left leader had said that in this party, there is only one post. The rest are all lampposts. So this kind of thing went on. And with Tatas going away, almost a few years before the left, before the Mamata Banerjee's Trinamool Congress came to power, the last nails, you could so to say, was driven into the coffin of West Bengal. Today, West Bengal is a shamshan. It is a wasteland. A lot of people say West Bengal should be spelled W-A-S-T-E Bengal. The boys and girls, they are hopeless. And there is rampant corruption. There was one time at which Mamata Banerjee was heralded as the champion of integrity, of honesty. Nobody says that anywhere, anytime, anymore. And there's rampant corruption. In the recruitment of teachers for secondary schools and primary schools, there was such corruption that the examinations for this recruitment, which were held as far back as in 2011, they have not yet, after this 11 years, they have still not been put into action because there was terrible corruption. Undeserving people were given posts, and the people who deserved it, they went to high court. challenged it, with the result that this is now the ministers are being hauled in. Now the ministers are being hauled in. Not only that, there are people like advisors in the entire structure who are being hauled in, and there is quite a possibility that they will be subjected to the rigors of the law. Apart from that, there is murder, of course, simple. And there is something called tolabazi. Tolabazi means extortion. This is the hallmark of Trinamool's rule. Tolabazi. You can do nothing without paying an extortionate amount of money to the local Trinamool boss. One film actor called Rudranil Ghosh, who was close to the BJP. In fact, he had run for elections from one of the constituencies where from Bhawanipur constituency as a BJP candidate. He is a film actor, not an absolutely class one actor, but he was a film actor. He says, for the last so many years, I have not been getting any job because I belong to the BJP. This is the kind of thing, this is the kind of over-politicization that takes place in the state. And all these matters, the latest thing, of course, some of you might have heard of it, in a tiny village called Bogtui, in the district of Birbhum, which is famous for Tagore's Shantiniketan. In this district of Bogtui, some nine people, including women and children, they have been burnt alive. And they were all Trinamool supporters. They have been burnt alive by a rival faction of Trinamool, because the rival faction, they were the leader of the rival faction, was one Bhadu Sheikh. This Bhadu Sheikh was murdered by people of this faction. So from that place, the rest of the people, the names like Rosina Bibi and all that, she had given a dying declaration saying that this is how we had been killed. First, they were butchered, they were sort of pierced with spears and all, and then they're dead or half dead. They were pushed into a cottage and sprinkled with kerosene, and the cottage was set on fire. The chief minister went there and was seen openly instructing the police as to how this is to be investigated. But some lawyers went to the High Court and immediately got it transferred, the task of investigation transferred to the CBI. Today, people have no faith in the state police. Practically anything of importance, and lately a lot of these murders and mayhem has gone on, cases of smuggling and all that, all of them have been entrusted to the CBI. So this is more or less a picture in the left-rule state and the quasi-left-rule state. The party which had promised a parivartan. Parivartan means change. From the left rule, they are still following in the footsteps of the left parties. So this is a thing about which the rest of India should be careful. Never, never bring a left party to power. Never, never give any kind of lift to any left party, however much intellectual they may seem, however much smart, however much erudite they may seem, never, never give any room to any left party. Otherwise, you will share the fate of West Bengal. Very recently, there was one comment all over the social media that people here are used to say, in particularly in CPM government's time, it used to be said, that however bad we are better than Bihar. Bihar is much worse. Of course, that was Lalu's Bihar. Now, this time, Bihar elections have happened and not a single murder. UP elections have happened and not a single murder. And West Bengal elections, I think about 140 murders have taken place before the election and after the election. I need not go into the gory details of some of these things. I know most of them, the details of all these murders and these tortures very well. One thing I can assure you that the police have done nothing. What police sometimes do when there's a lot of pressure, they arrest someone, put him in jail custody, then don't give him a charge sheet for 90 days. After 90 days, if you don't give a charge sheet, that person gets bail and goes scot-free. This is the kind of thing that has been done. So this is, in a nutshell, whatever I could say in this short period of time, the look of left rule and quasi-left rule, and that is it.
What is the impact of the Rohingyas and the illegal Bangladeshis who are like in large numbers in West Bengal on their infrastructure, on their jobs, education sector and all?
The Rohingyas are not even Bangladeshi citizens. They were driven out by the Myanmaris to Bangladesh because Myanmar is a predominantly Buddhist country. And these people, these Rohingyas, the bulk of them who are Muslim, they were causing problems over there. So something happened and then they moved over to Bangladesh. They live in a particular corner of Chittagong district, Cox Bazar district actually. And from there, they try to leak out and eventually, of course, come to West Bengal. And in West Bengal, they are welcomed because they swell the vote bank of this so-called secular parties. You must understand that a secular, who is a secular? A secular is one who never says anything against a Muslim, however wrong thing a Muslim has done. A secular is one who never says anything. On the other hand, anybody who has said anything in favor of Hindus can never be secular. He is communal. This value system was grafted on this nation by Jawaharlal Nehru, earlier than that by Mohandas Karamchand Gandhi, and this has been sanctified by the leftists. This has been sanctified by a whole lot of pet and paid intellectuals, so-called intellectuals. So that this had got into the Bengali psyche and nobody bothered about it. Meanwhile, this kind of infiltration went on. Certain parts of the state are such that the demographic composition has completely changed. See, West Bengal was during the partition of India, West Bengal was partitioned. Province of Bengal was partitioned on the basis of religion. The part which was Hindu majority came to India. The part which was Muslim majority went to East Pakistan, now Bangladesh. Now this part which came to India, out of that, three districts are Muslim majority. These are all mostly infiltrators. Plus there has been the role of procreation, of course, is there. In Assam, situation is even worse. But the Assamese were not so oblivious of their danger, and therefore from the 1980s, they had been agitating against this, and it has been a good thing, with the result that there had been we all know what different legislations that had taken place, but there was no such thing in Bengal because here we are leftists. We are here, leftists are here to dispense love and compassion to the whole world. What difference does it make whether a person is a Hindu or a Muslim or an Indian or a Bangladeshi or even a Myanmarese? They are all welcome. They all come here. We will not stop anyone. This was the kind of attitude. And this had happened. As a result of that, three districts have become Muslim majority. And there are parts of West Bengal where it is difficult for a Hindu to survive, to live. They are forced. They are not killed or anything. But there is social pressure, economic pressure, with the result that they are forced to leave those places. Those places which they leave, they are lapped up by the Muslims who are coming across the border. And that is that.
One more thing, sir. I'm not aware of this. What are the citizenship laws in India? Like if an illegal Bangladeshi or a Rohingya has children, are they automatically deemed Indian citizens or what? How does it work?
No, nothing of the sort. Nothing of the sort. But the point is that there is no mechanism yet for pushing the illegal Bangladeshi or illegal Rohingya out of India. The government, present government, had legislated the CAA, the Citizenship Amendment Act, and the NRC, that is National Register of Citizens Act, with great difficulty. And everybody blessed them. All Hindus who had been driven out of Bangladesh by Islamic persecution, they all blessed them. But so far, these laws have not been given teeth, because in order to give a law teeth, rules have to be framed, and these rules have not been framed. Hopefully, they will be framed in the near future. Then we'll see some kind of difference. But until then, these illegal Bangladeshis, illegal Rohingyas, they are staying put because they have the support of the state government.
Going on from your question, your answers to the lady here about the Rohingyas and the Bangladeshis infiltrating into India,
yes,
and becoming a vote bank. But how can they become a vote bank if they aren't citizens? I thought only the citizens of the country are allowed to be on the voters' list. How can they vote?
That is very simple. They are given a ration card by the local panchayat. The panchayat is under the ruling party.
Yeah.
The local, they simply go to the panchayat, they concoct some kind of antecedent that they were born in India or their father was born in India or something like that, and they are given ration cards. Then on the strength of that ration card, they get an electoral card. It's very simple. It's all over the state.
Yeah, okay. No, I don't live in India, so I don't know the intricacies of what happens.
Okay.
I just thought, as a citizen here where I am, that I can vote. But I didn't realize that was that simple for the corrupt system, you know, to have so many people coming in without any problem. Okay, so another question from your earlier talk. You said that there was a time when West Bengal was under president's rule, because of all the troubles there. Did I understand that correctly? There was one stage after 1967.
That's right. Between 1967 and 72.
Yeah. So
I think there were three spells of president's rule.
Okay. So there must have been a lot of agitation, a lot of problems at that time. I will read up more about it now, obviously, after this talk.
I mentioned that Saibari incident. That was during that time.
Okay, so must have been a very severe kind of a situation at that time for the president's rule to be established. So what is happening in West Bengal? I know a little bit now since last 1 year. Doesn't that also qualify for the president's rule to be implemented in the West Bengal?
I personally think so. Now, finally, what happens is up to the central government. I personally think that it certainly does qualify for the president's rule.
Okay. All right, let's hope, wait and see what happens.
I don't know which country you live in. You live in the United States by any chance?
No, UK, in UK.
UK, yeah. UK, of course, it's an island country, so you won't have that problem.
We've got a lot of immigrants.
They're accounted
for. Illegal ones,
in the United States, in places like Texas and California, huge lot of Mexicans filter in. And they have an immigrant problem over there.
Yeah, they have a huge one as well. I mean, we've got, because they are just coming in from Europe, they're just being pushed out into the English Channel, and that's what we get over here now. Yeah.
Right.
What is the BJP strength has increased in West Bengal since the last election? This is what I read. And what are the chances that, seeing what is happening at the moment, that more and more people will be drawn, looking at the progress in the BJP rule states in India, other BJP rule, what is your prediction, or what do you feel would be the trajectory for the BJP control in the coming years?
Adam, I am a BJP supporter right now and a BJP ordinary member. I was very active in the BJP. I was state president. I was member of the BJP national executive. So whatever answer I give, you must understand that I am saying these things from my own conviction.
Yes.
I think that the BJP rule in India has been a boon for the whole country, the way way this country was going all these years. It has been reversed, and the one person who is responsible for it more than anyone else is Narendra Modi. I just can't explain what a great man he is, but this is not the way to wax eloquent on him. And there were other people also. BJP is not a person who is not a party which respects persons, but Narendra Modi is someone, really someone. Yes. That is number one. Yeah. Number two is that you ask me about West Bengal. I would not like to elaborate on this thing, but I would only say that BJP has committed political suicide in West Bengal. It could have come to power in 2021. They simply let it slip through their fingers.
Okay. I mean, from what I've been reading, I think is BJP left... brought in a lot of outsiders, you know, to stand for elections.
Yes, that is one reason. You are absolutely right. That is one reason.
That is what, because people at the at ground level did not gel with these outsiders. And I think that Mamata Banerjee is the government they stuck on to, you know, they had their strategist. I forget his name now. And they said, bahar ka log aate hai, bahar ka log aate hai, karke. That was, I think, a great...
Those people have mostly left now. Yeah. Those people have mostly left BJP and gone back to Trinamool Congress.
Yeah, they did that, yes, because they were frightened. I think they were more because they were frightened, yeah.
No, not frightened. They came here for money and pelf. Money and pelf and power. Then they found that they couldn't win the election, so they've gone back.
Oh, dear.
Unspeakable.
I will wait for your book.
Thank you.
Thank you.
So would you like to give any concluding remarks? And what are BJP's chances, or what is the, what can it correct for before the next election to come into power in West Bengal?
Right now, the BJP organization is in some disarray. And I would say that the most important thing for the BJP to do is to set the organization right, and particularly have a very efficient Prabhari. Prabhari is the central observer who takes care, who supervises the working of the state party and who reports on the state party to the central party. So this is one thing that I think ought to be done immediately. And that is about all that I am prepared to say now. More perhaps later.